जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी, जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी, जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी। गोपी जना वल्लभा गिरिवर धारी, गोपी जना वल्लभा गिरिवर धारी, यशोदानन्दन व्रज जन रंजन, यशोदानन्दन व्रज जन रंजन, यमुना तीरा वनचारी, यमुना तीरा वनचारी, जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे रामा हरे रामा राम रामा हरे हरे। कृष्ण हरे हरे, हरे राम हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। हरे राम हरे राम, हरे कृष्ण हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। हरे परमहंस परिव्राजकाचार्य अष्टोत्तर शतश्री श्रीमद्वैन गिरीशरण अरविंद भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी श्रील प्रभुपाद की, अनंत कोटि वैष्णववृंद की, रामाचार्य हरदास ठाकुर की, प्रेम से कहो श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद की, श्री रूप सनातन भट्ट रघुनाथ श्री जीव गोपाल भट्ट दास रघुनाथ षड गोस्वामी प्रभुगण की, गंगामय यमुनामय की, भक्ति देवी तुलसी देवी की जय। ऑल ग्लोरीज टू असेंबल्ड डिवोटीज, all glories assembled devotees, all glories assembled devotees, all glories to Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. ओम अज्ञानतिमिरन्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकया चक्षुःवन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपः कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं। वन्देऽहं श्रीगुरो श्रीयुतपदकमलं श्रीगुरून् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सहगणरघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनासहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधा कृष्णपादान् सहगणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च। नमावों विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिनिति नामिने। नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषशून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्रीकृष्णचैतन्यप्रभुनित्यानन्द श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादिगौरभक्तवृन्द। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। Hare Krishna, welcome all of you for the fourth verse of Ishopanishad, right, today. First, we will recite all the shlokas now. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Ishavasyamidam Sarvam Yatkincha Jagatyam Jagat Tena Tyaktena Bhunjita Magridakasya Siddhanam कुर्वन् नेवेह कर्माणि जिजीविषेत् शतं समाः एवं त्वयि नान्यते तोस्ति न कर्म लिप्यते नरे असुर्या नाम ते लोका अंधेन तमसावृताः तांस्ते प्रीत्याभिगच्छन्ति एके चात्महनो जनाः अनेजदेकं मनसो जवीयो नैनदेवा आप्नुवन् पूर्वमर्षत् तद्धावतोऽन्यानत्येति तिष्ठत्तस्मिन्नपो मातरिश्वा दधाति तदे जति तन्नै जति तद्धूरे तद्वन्तिके तदन्तरस्य सर्वस्य तदु सर्वस्यास्य बाह्यतः यस्तु सर्वाणि भूतानि आत्मन्येवानुपश्यति सर्वभूतेषु चात्मानं ततो न विजुगुप्सते यस्मिन् सर्वाणि भूतानि आत्मैवाभूद्विजानतः तत्र को मोहकशोक एकत्वं मनुपश्यतः सपर्यगाशुक्रमकायमव्रणम् अस्नाविरं शुद्धमपापविद्धं कविर्मनीषी परिभूस्वयंभू जाता दत्त्यदोर्तान् व्यदधाच्छाश्वतीभ्यः समाभ्यः अन्धं तमः प्रविशन्ति ये अविद्यामुपासते ततो भूय इव ते तमो यौ विद्यायां व्रताः अन्यदेवाहुर्विद्यया अन्यदाहुरविद्यया इति शुश्रुमधीराणां येनस्तद्विच चक्षिरे विद्यां च अविद्यां च यस्तद्वेदो भयं सः विद्यया मृत्युं तीर्त्वा विद्ययामृतमश्नुते अन्धं तमः प्रविशन्ति ये असम्भूतिमुपासते ततो भूय इव ते तमो यौ सम्भूत्यां व्रताः अन्यदेवाहुसम्भवात् अन्यदाहुरसम्भवात् इति सुश्रुमधीराणां येनस्तद्विच चक्षिरे सम्भूतिं च विनाशं च यस्तद्वेदो भयं सः विनाशेन मृत्युं तीर्त्वा सम्भूत्यामृतमश्नुते हिरण्मयेन पात्रेण सत्यस्यापि हितं मुखं तत्त्वं पूषण्णपावृणु सत्यधर्माय दृष्टये पूषन्नेकर्षे यमसूर्यप्राजापत्य व्यूहरश्मीन् समूहतेजो यत्ते रूपं कल्याणतमं तत्ते पश्यामि योऽसावसौ पुरुषः सोऽहमस्मि वायुनलिलम् अमृतम् अतेदं भस्मान्तं शरीरम् ॐ क्रतो स्मर कृतं स्मर क्रतो स्मर कृतं स्मर अग्ने नया सुपतेराय अस्मान् विश्वानि देववयुनानि विद्वान् योऽद्यस्मज्जुहुराणमेनो भूयिष्ठां ते नमो भुक्तिं विधेम। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे। Let's proceed to mantra 4 today. Anejadekam manasojaviyo Naina deva apnuvan purvamarshat Taddhavatonyanatyeti tishthat Tasminnapo matarishvada dati. Read the word to word, please.
Anejat. Fixed. Ekam. One. Manasah. Then the mind. Javiyah. More swift. Na. Not. Enat. This Supreme Lord. Devah. The demigods like Indra, etc. Apnuvan. Can approach. Purvam. In front. Arshat, moving quickly. Tat, he. Dhavatah, those who are running. Anyan, others. Atyeti, surpasses. Tishthat, remaining in one place. Tasmin, in him. Apah, rain. Matarishva, the gods who control the wind and rain. Dadhati, supply. Although fixed in his abode, the personality of Godhead is swifter than the mind and can overcome all others running. The powerful demigods cannot approach him. Although in one place, he controls those who supply the air and rain. He surpasses all in excellence.
Dhavata means to run. Lord is fixed in his own abode. But he is swifter than the mind and he can overcome all others running. Nobody can catch up with him. Although he is situated in one place, he is standing, all demigods are running, still who wins the race? Lord wins the race. Like that he says. He surpasses all the gods in excellence. It is said, isn't it? So, we will read one pastime from Kena Upanishad. Here the disciple is asking a question. Om kene shitam patati preshitam manaha kena pranaha pratamaha praiti yuktaha kene shitam vacham imam vadanti chakshustrotram kau devo yunakti. This is the first chapter, first verse of Kena Upanishad. So the word, very meaning of the word Kena means by whom? By Kena Upanishad. So it's all about by whom this whole world is running, by whom the mind is running towards its desired object. Like that. How the, our Jnanendriyas and Karmendriyas get the push to run towards their objects. How? If you see, the prana pushes the Karmendriyas and the intelligence pushes the Jnanendriyas. So, act in that way. Like in the morning, when we offer the worship to the Lord with the 5 wicks, how powerful are those fires, isn't it? Like that our 5 senses are very powerful, Jnanendriyas. But they are activated by the intelligence. Intelligence actually, of course, intelligence is superior to mind. They all supply information to the mind, but mind cannot decide independently without consulting with the intelligence. So, intelligence pushes the Jnanendriyas, while the prana pushes the karmendriyas, like hands, legs, genitals, anus, rectum. But now the intelligence and the prana are also connected. If the intelligence is impure, then it will guide the prana to push the working senses in a wrong way also. So therefore, we have to purify the mind and intelligence. Like senses you purify by Rishikena Rishikesha Sevanam. That's why you purify the senses, engaging senses in Lord's service. And the mind you purify by chanting. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Yan Nama Shuti Matrena, Puman Bhavati Nirmalaha. Man becomes Nirmal, he says. Then Buddhi you purify
by the shastric study which gives rise to viveka buddhi, and discriminatory intelligence you get. What is right, what is wrong, what is good, what is bad, what I should do, what I should not do. Tasmat shastra pramanante karya karya vyavasthita. So the intelligence becomes purified by shastric study. It becomes purer and purer. The more you study sincerely, the truth starts revealing itself in the intelligence. The ego is purified by living in the association of devotees. So, because the devotees will purify our ego. If you are living alone in the forest, you can be a big yogi. And one may fall down if Menaka comes. Whereas if you live in the company of devotees, by the end of your life, you will be Trinadapi, Shunichana, Tarurapi, Sakshana. Humbly, you can go back to Godhead. Just live it. Prabhupada gave the example of putting all the diamonds, you know, which you have just brought from the mountains. At that time, the diamond looks very blackish. It's very, very rough, with sharp ends. You put them in the box and then you put on the plug. All of them get, they upgrade one another. As sharp as they are, they can nicely upgrade the other ones. Correct? And then after that, you know, after several hours, you switch off and open and see everything is shining. So that kata kata is the life in the association of devotees. We all polish each other. Prabhupada gives the example. I'm just repeating. So, therefore, he is asking the question here. Inspired by whom does the mind run towards its desired object? Inspired by whom does the chief prana carry out its functions? And people speak the words inspired by whom? And which devata engages the eye and the ear? Like that he is asking. Kena preshita? He is asking. That's a question disciple is asking. And then the guru is telling here. Oh, student is saying, the deva who is the power behind hearing, the devata, the power behind the mind. See, power behind the hearing is who? Digdevatas. Power behind the mind is Soma. Power behind the speech is Agni. The power behind the prana and the power behind the sight is that person alone. That means that supreme person. He is the person behind everything. The wise persons who know this surpass the gross body and become liberated from the subtle body also. They attain immortality. See, when the gross body stops functioning, it is called death. When the subtle body stops functioning, it's called moksha. And when the soul revives his spiritual nature, that is called attaining the swarupa, which is muktir hitva anyata rupam swarupena vyavastiti. So there are three levels of liberation. First level of liberation is from one material body, but then there is useless liberation because you get one more material body. Second level of liberation is moksha from the subtle body. Very good, Brahma Jyoti. But Brahma Jyoti, you have not revived your true ego. Only false ego is removed. But then when you get the true ego, true identity, that's a third level of liberation and ultimate liberation, and that is real immortality. Correct, no? Yeah. So here, asked by the student, the Acharya begins to speak. He's saying, see, the answer which he gave just now, Shrotrasya Shrotram Manaso Manoyat Vachoha Vacham Sau Pranasya Pranah Chakshushas Chakshur Adimuchya Dhiraha Pretyasman Lokat Amrita Bhavanti. He's saying, is the ear of the ear, mind of the mind, word of the word? What is the meaning of that? That means our eyes are presided by Surya, and he gives the ability for the Surya to activate the eyes of all living entities. That ability is given to Surya by whom? Supreme Lord. Like that, that's why this Kena Upanishad is telling. Like we are able to hear why. Actually, behind every action, like, you know, seeing, hearing, touching, smelling, tasting, all of them, five things are required. They explained in the Srimad Bhagavatam in one verse. For example, I have to see, then to see an object, I need the eyeball instrument in the gross body. The subtle body, there is chakshu also. Without the chakshu in the subtle body, grass instrument has no meaning. Like my specs, is it useful without the eyeball? It's like that only. The instrument eyeball is there in the grass body. Then subtle body has a chakshu also, which is the actual chakshu, which goes from body to body. This is only external apparatus, this one, this eye. And then the third thing is the presence of the soul. And then the fourth thing is the Surya Devata, who is the presiding deity of my eye. He is required. And then the fifth personality is Super Soul. So the four items which I told you now, they all are dependent on Paramatma. And the fifth Paramatma is called Swa-Ashray-Ashray, is called. In Bhagavatam, if you put this word, you'll get it. Swa-Ashray-Ashray means what? He is the shelter of himself only. He has no other shelter. But the previous four items have shelter in Paramatma. That's it. Same thing he is saying. Shrotrasya-Shrotram, Manaso-Manoyad, Vacho-Hi-Vacham. What is the meaning of that? That means, you know, he is the eye of the eye. He is saying that means, you know, the devatas may control the power of sight for a living entity, but they themselves are powerless without him. Like that he says. Yeah. Yeah, he's antaryami for the voice, ear, eye, prana, everything. Yeah. Na tatra chakshur gacchati, na vag gacchati no manaha, na vidmo na vijanimo, yataitat anushishyat. He's saying, the supreme entity cannot be seen by material eye. The material faculty of speech cannot convey him by speaking. The mind cannot conceive of him. I do not know that supreme entity. Here, refer to the verse 2.2. He says, for more details on this point, you have to understand that. What is the meaning of I don't know? He says here, in the Vedanta, it is said that if a person tells that I know the absolute truth, or if a person says, I absolutely don't know anything about the truth, both fellows don't know. The person who knows absolute truth, everybody can only know something of the absolute truth. See, here it says, Yuktena manasa vayam devasya savituhu save suvargeyaya shaktya, which means, with the permission of the Lord, may we engage our minds, be endowed with powers of concentration in order to attain the spiritual world, he says. Which means, if Lord permits to know him, to that degree you can know him. And you cannot fathom him completely. Like if you have a big heap of sugar, one ant can pick up how much sugar? Little bit, maybe one or two cubes, and then he can be jumping and dancing in ecstasy. I got sugar. But what sugar he knows? He just knows one small bit of it. Similarly, the Lord's reality is so exhaustive that you can only know a little bit of it. Therefore, Guru himself says that I cannot completely say I can fathom him. Whatever he allows me to know about him, that much I know. Like that he says. And then it goes here, but the purpose I am going into this is, I'll tell you, there is a pastime which will come here. Just 1 minute. Correct. Here comes this is a very important thing. Third chapter of Kena Upanishad, the great Yaksha. Here, the Supreme Lord Brahman, he alone gave the victory to the devatas. Though it was victory to the Supreme Personality, astoundingly, the devatas worshipped themselves and they became proud. They thought, this is our victory, this is our glory. That the devatas thought like that. Vijayo asmakam evayam mahimeti. Mahima iti. This is by my mahima, I conquered the asuras. Like that the devatas were thinking. So at that time, you know, Taddaisham Vijagnyau Tebhyo Saha. Okay, I will read this one. Pradur Babuva Tanna Vijanata Kim Idam Yakshamiti. At that time, Lord Vishnu knew the pride of the devatas, and by his inconceivable power, he appeared before them in an astonishing form. The devatas could not understand who the worshipable entity was. He says, so, what is the astonishing form? Vishnu didn't come directly as Vishnu to them. He assumed the form of a yaksha. And he appeared in front of them. And then the devata said to Agni, oh Agni, who is the worshipable person in front of us? Go and investigate who he is. Agni said, let it be. Agni went towards the yaksha. Tad abhyadravat tam abhyavadat ko Kositi. He asked him, who are you? Ko asi? He asked him. And then he is saying, Agnirva aham asmi iti abravid jata veda va aham asmi iti. Actually, when Agni was asked by the Yaksha, who are you? Agni in answer to that said, I am called Agni and I am called as a jata vedas. And then Vishnu told him, what power is in such a famous person as you? And Agni said, I can sarvam daheyam yadidam prithivyamiti. On this earth, tell me, anything on the earth I can burn down. Like that he said. And then tasmai trinam nidadi etad daheti. He kept one trinam, one grass in front of him and said, etad daheti. Please kindly burn this. Like that he told him, yeah. Then what happens? He said, Agni approached with great speed, approaching grass, but with all his strength, he just could not get anywhere near it, he says. And then he returned to the devatas and said, I could not understand who that yaksha was. He's so powerful. Naitat ashakam, he says, vignatum, yad yetat yakshamiti. I don't know who is his personality. I don't know what he did miracle with me. I couldn't burn it down, he says. And then the devatas said to Vayu, hey, Vayu, he said, Atha vayum abruvan. Vayav, etad bijanihi. Hey, you go and tell us more about that worshipful person. Kim yetad yaksham iti tateti. Just find out who that personality is. And then Vayu went there. Tad abhyadravat. Tam abhyavadat. Ko asi iti. When he went and reached there, Vayu, immediately that yaksha asked him, Ko asi, who are you? He asked him, Vayur vaham asmi iti. My name is Vayu, he said. Abravin Matarishwa Va Aham Asmiti. He said that, I am called Matarishwa because I can travel swiftly in space, he said. Quickly, my wind blows very fast, no? Like that, he said. Tasmin Svayi Kim Viryamiti. And then that Yaksha asked him, what is the power in such a famous person as you? And then Vayu said, I can carry away anything on this earth, he said. Api Idam Sarvam adadeyam yad idam prithivyamiti. Anything on earth you put it, I can carry it away. He said like that. Tasmai trinam nidadi. Again he kept the trinam in front of him. Etad adatsva ititat upapreyaya. He's saying, here is a grass. Please pick up this piece of grass by your wind. You blow it, he said. And while you enthusiastically approach the grass, with all his strength he could not pick up the grass. Like that he says, see, sarva javena tanna shashaka datum sa tata eva nivabrite naita tashakam. And then he's saying, na yeta tashakam vignatum. I don't know why I'm not able to pick up this grass. Yeta yakshamiti. I don't know who is this personality yaksha. He also felt like that. And then in the last, he says that, atendram Abruvan. At that time, the devatas went to the leader of the devatas. Who is that? They told, oh, Magavan, Indra, please find out who that worshipable person is. Indra said, so be it. And he approached the yaksha now. But the yaksha disappeared from that place at that time. When Indra came there. And Indra approached a woman, the lustrous Uma, the daughter of Himalaya. Sa tasmin eva kashe Striyam Ajagam. On the way he came across Mother Uma, that is Gauri, wife of Shiva. Bahushobamanam Umam Haimavatim Tam Hovachakim Yetad Yakshamiti. So he is asking her. She was established in the sky. She's asking by the Yaksha to teach. And he said to her, who was that worshipable person? He's asking her. Now she will give answer. You can hear what she says. Uma is going to speak. She is saying, that yaksha is Brahman. In the war between devatas and asuras, Brahman gave you victory. But you became proud, thinking it's our victory. By these words of Uma, Indra could understand that yaksha was Brahman. Brahmanova yetad vijaye mahiyadvam miti tato haiba. Like that it goes on. And then therefore these devatas are considered superior to others because the Agni, Vayu, Indra, they all understood Brahman was close by. They first understood that the Yaksha was Supreme Brahman. And then Indra is considered to be superior to all devatas. So he contacted the Yaksha now, who was situated nearby. So he was the first to understand that the Yaksha was actually the Supreme Lord. He was the first one to understand. And then his nature is, made to be understood by us by this kind of examples, he says. Yeah. So, and it goes on like this. See, the student is asking finally. See, taddha tadvanam nama tadvanam iti upasitavyam. Saya etat evam vedahabihainam sarvani bhutani sambhashyanti. He says that Supreme Brahman is well known as Tadvana or Vishnu. He's saying Tadvana means the Lord who is present in every atom. Super soul. And Vanam means actually worshipable Lord. Worshipable Lord who is situated in every atom and space between the atoms. Yeah. The result of worship of that Tadvana Lord is that one becomes qualified to know him gradually. By worshipping him, you come to know him. Like that he says, the Guru tells a disciple. He says that all the entities respect that person. And anyone who worships him with great sincerity eventually will come to know him. By his own mercy only. That's what he says. Now the disciple is asking now. Upanishadam bho bruhi iti uktata upanishad. Brahmim vavata upanishadam abhrumeti. And the student is telling teacher, oh teacher, please teach me the Upanishad. And the teacher said, I have already completed the Upanishad. Teacher is telling. So student was telling, teacher is telling some nice story today. Now he is going to start the actual class, he thought. But the guru told him, my dear disciple, this is the Upanishad, Kyan Upanishad. And he completed. Yeah. Because generally, why the student was confused, there is a reason for it. Because gender Upanishad, you don't get this type of pastimes. So you are supposed to get something little more dry than this. Where you talk about the sat, asat, vichar and all that. So therefore the disciple was asking, okay, can you start the class today? And Guru said, what class? This is the Upanishad for today. It's over now. You can go back. So very interesting verse, no? Last part. Isn't it? So that's what is said here. Although in one place he controls those who supply the air and rain. This is the meaning of that. Lord is how he is controlling the people like Vayu, Agni, Indra, Chandra, correct, no? The same is explained in the Vedanta Sutra. See, what is Vedanta Sutra? Vedanta Sutra is a summary of all the Upanishads. The conclusion of all the Upanishads given in short. And the Srimad Bhagavatam is Bhashyam Brahma Sutrana. So, Bhagavatam you will find one verse. Yam Brahma Varunendra Rudra Marutastun Manti Divyaistavai Vedai Sangha Padakramo Panishadair Gayanti Yam Samagaha Dhyana Vastita Tadgatena Manasa Pashyanti Yam Yogino Yasyantam Na Vidussura Suraganaha Deva Yatasmai Namo. That verse says that Yam Brahma, Indra, Chandra, Varuna, Vayu, Agni, they all are worshipping you. First line. Second line talks about Vedas, Upanishads, Puranas, Vedanta. They are also worshipping you with beautiful poetry, verses and all. Then thirdly, he says that the Ashtanga Yogis in the forest are meditating on you in their own hearts. To that Lord Vasudeva, I bow down and offer my salutations, like that he says. There is another verse spoken in the Garbhastuti prayers by Devatas. Nanamarupe gunajanma karmabhir nirupitavye tapatasya sakshinah mano vachobhyam anumeya vartmano devakriyayam pratiyantyatapihi. This verse is a very beautiful verse. Nanama rupe guna janma karma vir. My dear Lord, your nama, your rupa, your guna, na nirupitavye. That means nobody can ascertain them, he says. Na nirupitavye tapatasya sakshinah. You are only the witness of those things. None of us can ascertain. But that in one situation they say that all this become understood. Even mano vachabhyam anumevatmana means by mana or by vacha one cannot ascertain. But devakriyayam pratyantite. Devakriya means devotional service. By devotional service, these things become understood. Your naam, roop, gun, everything. So, which means like we say, sevan mukehi. The same thing. You do devotional service, then gradually Lord becomes manifest in the heart of a devotee, little by little. So, and that is the Supreme Lord who surpasses all the devatas, you see. Please read the purport. Yeah. Through
mental speculation, even the greatest philosopher cannot know the Supreme Lord, who is the absolute personality of Godhead. He can be known only by his devotees through his mercy. In the Brahma Samhita 5.34, it is stated that even if a non-devotee philosopher travels through space at the speed of the wind or the mind for hundreds of millions of years, he will still find that the absolute truth is far, far away from him.
Pantastu koti shatavatsara sampragamyo vayo rathapi manaso munipungavanam sopyasti yat prapatasimya vichintya tatve govindam adipurusham tamaham bhajami. Govindam Adipurusham Tamaham Bhajami. That's a very beautiful verse. Pantastu Koti. What is the meaning of that? He says, Koti Shata Vatsara Sampra. Shata means 100 and Koti means crore. So 100 crore miles, if you have to cross, one can cross with the mind in one moment. And there are not just the munis, but Muni Pungava. Muni Punga means leader of munis. So the leaders of rishis, they are like in the Himalayas. Even now there are some rishis who are 300, 400 years old. Even now there are people who have found out such people are existing. So sometimes they would live for thousands of years also, these fellows. So they can meditate in such a powerful way with the mind. They can travel at the speed of mind. And they are leaders of the rishis and munis. And this verse says that Vayor athapi manaso munipungavana. Vayor means like the wind. First they can travel at the speed of wind, but if they mature in their sadhana and they become more mature, then they can travel at the speed of mind. First wind and then mind. Just like our Parashuram. When you would start the war, rotating the Parashu, no? First it will be speed of wind. First wind. Wind speed. And then mind speed after that. Mind is even more faster. Extremely, it's lightning. It looks like a chakra only. You will rotate in such a way that nobody can go near. So, in the same manner, these people, Pantastu, these Muni Pungavas are sitting and meditating and understanding absolute truth. And after reaching that greatest height of realization, they can only see the shining toenail of Krishna at the most. And they cannot reach any realization. Like that he says. This verse says that. On the other hand, that Krishna can be known only by his devotees through his mercy. What is that verse? He says, no? Ittam satam brahma sukhanu bhutya dasyam gatanam paradaivatena mayashritanam naradarakena sakam vijarhu kritapunya punjaha. That verse says. What this verse says? That Sukadeva Goswami very beautifully describes I will just show you that. Kechit vanu venun vadayanto. I will just show you that 1 minute. Singha, very beautiful verse. Because unless you see this, you will not be able to appreciate. You can repeat it also. Kechit venun vadayanto. Bhanta shringani kechana. Kechit bringai pragayantaha gojantah kokilai pare. See, when the covered boys entered the forest along with Krishna, some of them were playing on their flutes, some of them were playing on their bugles. Yesterday, our Vrindavachandra was having a very beautiful bugle. Did you observe that? My Lord, with golden red color, very long one, very attractive one, isn't it? On the side, you saw them? So, that is a bugle. So, they would play on the bugle. So, Bhanta Shringani Kechana. And, yeah. And sometimes they imitated the bringa. The bringa will fly. And they will also make similar sounds like the bringa. Kujanta kokilai pare. Sometimes the cuckoos would coo. Actually, the cuckoo speaking also is asking something to the other cuckoo.
Coo.
They would make a sound. The other cuckoo also will respond. Coo. But before the other cuckoo will respond, the boys will respond. So the cuckoo will be wondering, hey, who else is giving answer? Looking around. So like that, they are playing games. Vichayabhi pradhavanto. Gacchanta sadhu hamsakaihi. Bakair upavishantascha. Nityantascha kalapibihi. So when the birds would fly, the boys would see the shadow on the ground and run behind the shadow to catch. And the boys would say, let us see who catches the shadow first. So they would run behind the shadow. And also gacchanta sadhu, the swans would be sitting very beautifully. When they would be walking, the walking of a swan is very beautiful. You have seen the goose walking with a long neck, how the goose, so they would also walk with it. And bakai rupavishan, sometimes the ducks would be sitting, they will go and sit next to the duck. They would move the body in the same manner as the duck. And when they would see the peacocks dancing, so they would also stand next to the peacock and dance in the same manner. They were imitating the birds, like this. Vikarshanta kishabalan. This is our monkeys. Monkeys, they would make show the teeth and make some. They would exactly imitate the monkeys. Arohantashchatair druman. And monkeys would see that the swallows are copying. They would become frightened. They would climb up the tree and they would climb along with the monkey. Up, arohanta means to climb up. Vikurvantashchatai sakam. Plavantashcha palashishu. Yeah. Let us see, what is this? Vikurvanta. Young monkeys. Oh, they are young monkeys. Kishabalan is young monkeys. Yeah. So, Vikurvanta exactly imitating them, Thai, with those monkeys. Sakam. Plavantashcha, they will glide in the tree. Palashishu. Just like children like to glide, you know that? Like sometimes when we were small kids, we would go to the marriage parties, no? So when you go in the from the third floor, you know, the staircase, we would come gliding in that this thing, the side wall, you know that? Children do like, and parents would be frightened. Hey, if you fall down on the other side, you can't count your bones, isn't it? Many times they'll give a good beating and go again. We would do that, coming down. Children somehow like that gliding, isn't it? Yeah. So that's what he is saying. They were coming in the trees, gliding down. Sakam bekair vilangantaha. Saritaha sravasamplutaha. See, the frogs would be watching all this side. And they would go and sit next to the frog. The frog perceiving some danger, it would jump. And then they would also jump with the frog. The frogs would jump into the Yamuna. And they would also jump inside Yamuna, he is saying. Vihasantastha pratichhaya. Shapantascha pratiswanan. See, sometimes they would call names and then when the echo would come, they would call curses to the echoes they would give. Neither is saying. And then comes this verse. Ittam satam brahma sukhanubhutya. Dasyam gatanam paradaivatena. Maya Shritanam Naradarakena Sakam Vijahru Vijahru Kritapunya Punjaha. The Supreme Lord Krishna played with his own pure devotees, these covered boys, just like ordinary friends. Krishna would see a well and he'd call all the friends, hey friends, come here. All friends would go and surround the well and watch, and Krishna would shout loudly, Kaun ho tum? Kaun ho tum? Kaun ho tum? Kaun ho tum? Like sound would come. And then Krishna would hear that and laugh, gada gada gada, laugh, and tell the friends, hey, I am asking this fellow, who are you? And he is asking me, who are you? And then now Krishna will give the answer, Main Nanda Baba ka putra hoon, Nanda Baba ka putra hoon, Nanda Baba ka putra hoon. Like that sound will come. Then Krishna again would laugh and say, hey, I am Nanda's son, I am saying, but that fellow is repeating, he is not Nanda's son. Who is inside? Like that you would. And then all the boys would curse, they go, hey, don't claim to be Nanda's son. You know? So in this way they were playing games. So that's what he is saying. The Sakam Vijahru Krita Punya Punja means these fellows, these jivas could become friends with Krishna like this. They could play with Krishna in the forest. On the other hand, those Pantastu Koti fellows, that rishis, they can only see the tip of the toenail of Krishna, and not to the nail also, only light coming from that. That's all they can see, he says. And there are others who accept Krishna as master and themselves as servant. Dasyam Gatana, Paradevatan, hey, Lord, Krishna is God, we are servants, whatever you want, we'll go to him. They are like that. They also haven't achieved a great status, but they are better than the other fellows. But Mayashitanam Naradarakena, that is 9.11 Bhagavad Gita. Avajananti, that is the third category. So in this way, one should know the position of covered boys is not ordinary. They have attained the status after Krita Punya Punjaha, heaps and heaps of Bhakti Sukriti, they have accumulated millions of lives. So therefore it is said here, he can be known only by his devotees through his mercy. Just like the sun, how will you see the sun? Can you see the sun with a torch light or something? What light is needed to see the sun? Sunlight. So same thing, you use the sunlight to see the sun, you use Krishna's mercy to see him. That's the point made here. They said the same thing. There's another one verse by Gajendra also. Nama Atma Pradipaya Sakshine Paramatmane Namo Giram Viduraya Manasascheta Samapi. See what he says. Atma Pradip is calling. Krishna is called Atma Pradip. Self-effulgent. That's the meaning of Atma Pradip. That means you can see him only by his light or his mercy. There's no other way. You can't see him in any other way. Now read further.
The Brahma Samhita 5.37.
What is that verse 5.37? You will see. Read further.
Further describes that the absolute personality of Godhead has his transcendental abode known as Goloka, where he remains and engages in his pastimes. Yet, by his inconceivable potencies, he can simultaneously reach every part of his creative energy.
Goloka dhamni nijadhamni tale chatasya. And then? Devi Mahesha Haridama Suteshu Teshu Tete Prabhava Nichita Vihitascha Yena Govindamadi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami. Just 1 minute, I'll show you. Goloka Yeva Nivasat Takilatma Bhuto. And then third line, Yeah, read that Goloka verse. No, this thing. Where is that? This is describing that only? That was 37, is it 37? Sure? Ananda Chinmaya Rasa Pratibhavita Vistavidya Yeva Nijarupataya Kalabihi Goloka Yeva Nivasatya Kilatma Bhuto Govindamadi Purusham Tamaham Vajam. Goloka Nivasati, he resides in Goloka, but Akilatma Bhuto. At the same time, he can be present everywhere also, correct? No? That is the point, just 1 minute. Because there I have shown the Mahesh Dham, Devi Dham, everything I have shown. Okay, later if I get it, I'll show you. That's very beautiful PPT, that one. Because I got it. This is the one. Okay, you can see this. See Lakshmi Narayan, worshipped reverentially. This is which pastime? Samudra Mantra. Where Narayan is the boss, everybody else is Das. Whenever they have trouble, approach the boss. Boss will arrange for one avatar for you. One avatar, Kurma avatar, then later on, Dhanvantri avatar, then Mohini avatar. Many avatars is expanded, correct? No? You just have to surrender to him. He takes care of you. So like that, he comes in various. See, so many avatars he came. Mohini avatar, correct, no? Yeah, this is Narayana, correct, no? Balaji, different forms, correct, no? So now we can go from Devi Dham onwards. Quickly read it.
Devi Dham. Living entities who desire to enjoy separately go there.
Go there means come here. We are here only. Devi Dham. Correct, no? Yeah. Yes.
Meant for fulfilling the living entity's desires and for his reformation.
Correct, no? So all material desires can be fulfilled here because provisions are there. But same time, it's meant for reforming our heart. Otherwise, we'll never return back. We'll be stuck here. Yes.
A temporary place of illusory enjoyment and constant suffering.
Yeah.
Conditioned by birth, old age, disease and death. The knowledge of the living entity is covered by ignorance and illusion. False ego makes the living entity identify with the material body.
Clear, no? This is a Devi Dham. Yeah. So I have shown the one Brahmanda. You see, there are millions of Brahmandas. And in that one Brahmanda I have shown is 14 planetary systems. Brahma sitting at the top of the lotus. And Devi is also present there. Yeah. Okay. See, the Devi, she takes part in everything. Srishti, Stiti and Pralaya. She has an active role in all the three. Then Mahesh Dham, beyond this. Yeah.
A marginal place between Devi Dham and Hari Dham. Not part of the spiritual world, nor the material world.
Like Shambhu Tattva. He is not Vishnu Tattva, he is not Jiva Tattva in between, like that.
No opportunity to serve the Supreme Personality of Godhead.
Yeah.
For impersonalists who want to merge into the transcendence. For liberated souls who have not realized the opulence of Hari Dhamma.
That means there are some Shiva worshippers who are 9 Mars, for example, 63 9 Mars in South India. They are pure devotees of Shiva. They have no material desires, but they have not yet become Hari Bhaktas. So they go to this abode of Shiva, which is Mahesh Dham in Kailash, where all of them will be transformed into female forms. There, except Shiva, nobody is a male there. They all become Parvati's associates there. And then they join the bhajan which Shiva leads. And then they become pure Hari Bhaktas. Then they will go to Vaikuntha after that.
The destination of Nirvana, the Buddha philosophy. System of Jnana makes one eligible to enter there.
Correct, no? This is called what Dham? Mahesh Dham. Yeah, actually Brahma Jyoti Mahesh Dham are same only. But those who are Buddhists, they will go to Nirvana. They will. And then those who are Brahmavadis, they will go to Brahma Jyoti. And those who are personal worshippers of Shiva, they will enter this place.
So, all three
and they are generally called Mahesh Dham because many of the Shaivites are also impersonalists. In that will be there, yeah, yes.
Hari Dham. General description of Vaikuntha.
Colorful, no? Beautiful.
General description of Vaikuntha. Vai means free, Kuntha means anxiety. Unlimited planets, each being unlimited. Once having gone there, we never return to the material world. Ever increasing pleasure and love. No artificial lighting. Everything is self-illuminating. Ever fresh, youthful, eternal, immortal. Each planet is predominated by a particular expansion of Narayana. Everyone and everything there is perfect. Everything is made of pure consciousness. Kamadhenu cows and Kalpa Vriksha. Described in Srimad Bhagavatam 3.15.12-14.
24. So this is Hari Dham. Vaikuntha, this is in Paravyoma, spiritual sky. Then?
Golokadham. The supreme spiritual planet in Vaikuntha. It is like the whole of a lotus flower. Other planets are the petals. Three divisions, Vrindavan, Mathura, Dwarka. It emanates the bright rays of effulgence, Brahma Jyoti, throughout the entire spiritual world. Krishna performs wonderful pastimes there and reveals his sweetness. Every step is a dance. Every word is a song.
Yeah. Yeah, there is every step of the dance. Yeah. See, here the verse you can repeat. And this is the same verse which you recited just now. We'll recite together.
Goloka namni nijadhamni talecha tasya devi mahesha haridama suteshu teshu pete prabhava nichaya vihitascha yena govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami.
Below, the planet named Goloka Vrindavan are the planets known as Devi Dham, Mahesh Dham and Hari Dham. These are opulent in different ways. They are managed by the Supreme Personality of Godhead Govinda, the original Lord, I offer my obeisances unto him. Brahma Samhita 5.43.
This I made for this recent Utkarsh. Beautiful, na? Yeah. Now you see, powerful verse. Ganesh told Parashuram in Brahma Vaivarta Puran, Eastern Division, Ganapati Kanda. You see, all of you repeat this. See, Ganesh speaking to Parashuram. All of you repeat.
Yato bhavanti vishwani.
Stula sukshma adhikani cha. Punastatra praliyanta. Evam eva muhur muhuhu. See, Ganesh is telling, this material world consists of gross and subtle, stula and sukshma. And this world is created and punah punah praliyanta. It's and destroyed. Bhutva bhutva. Muhu muhu means again and again. So he's talking about which world? Material world. He's talking. And then he's saying, go loka urdvam vaikunthat. पंचाशत कोटि योजनः नास्ति लोकस्तत् ऊर्ध्वं च नास्ति कृष्णात् परप्रभुः इदं श्रुतं शंभुवक्त्रान् मया ते कथितम्. She is saying गोलोक ऊर्ध्वं वैकुंठात् अबव वैकुंठात् देयर इज अ प्लैनेट कॉल्ड गोलोका एंड हाउ मच अबव इट इज 50 crore yojanas, panchashat koti, 50 crore yojanas, my lord, one yojana itself is very big. 50 crore yojanas means, you cannot imagine, huh? Very much above. And then he's saying, nasti loka, lokastha dvurdvamcha, he's saying. Nasti lokastha dvurdvamcha, there is no other loka beyond Goloka, he's saying. And nasti krishnat paraprabhu, and there is no prabhu beyond Krishna, he's saying. There is no planet beyond that planet. There is no personality beyond Krishna. Because sometimes there are some people who claim to be, they say that, you know, Radha and Krishna come from some personality. And that personality is ultimate. Like that they declare, some people. Therefore he says there is nobody, no Paraprabhu, nobody else beyond Krishna, he says. And then how I know this fact? Ganesha says, Idam Shrutam Shambhu Vaktran. I heard it from the mouth of my father, Shambhu, is saying. And then I have told you now, he's saying. So he's talking about Goloka Dham, above Haridham. See, Ganesha and Parashama situated in between, discussing about Haridham and Goloka Dham. Nice, no? Yeah. So that's what is explained here. Complete that para.
In the Vishnu Purana, his potencies are compared to the light, to the heat and light that emanate from a fire. Although situated in one place, a fire can distribute its light and heat for some distance. Similarly, the absolute personality of Godhead, although fixed in his transcendental abode, can diffuse his different energies everywhere.
Ekadeshasitasyagner jyotsna vistaraniyata. And then, what is that name? Parasya brahmana shaktis. Tenedam akilam jagat, that's a verse. In one place, eka desha sthitasya agni, means in a dark room, we keep the lamp in the middle of the room. Eka desha sthitasya agni. Jyotsna vistaraniyata, that spreads light all over the room. Like the Krishna situated in Goloka, but he spreads his energies everywhere. Correct, no? Like for example, sun is located in one part of the world, but it is spreading its light practically everywhere. Correct, no? All around. In the same manner, he is saying that this Vishnu Purana says that Lord has multiple energies. And what are those energies? There is another verse. Vishnu Shakti, I'll have to repeat this, very important verse.
Vishnu Shakti para prokta, Kshetra Gnyakya tatha para, Tritiya, Avidya Karma Sanyaya, Tritiya Shakti Rishyate,
saying Vishnu Shakti para prokta. There are Lord Vishnu is transcendental and he has multiple potencies. One energy is called Kshetrajna. Kshetrajna Kyata Tapara. That is the marginal potency. Correct? No? Then there is a Aparashakti, Parashakti, which is material world and spiritual world. So there is a Antaranga Shakti, which is spiritual world. And Bahiranga Shakti, which is material world. And then Tatasa Shakti, which is all of us. So in this way, this is not the only three energies. There are innumerable energies, but three are prominent. Either prominent categories, he's saying. So, like these three energies are emanating from him, like the light emanating from fire. Like that he is saying. That's the explanation. So, Srila Prabhupada used to several times explain this and three energy thing. Very, very important. Actually, if you describe to people in this way about the material energy, and like that was 7.4, what is that? Bhumi Rapa Analava you come. That was. And then the spiritual energy, which is Apareyamita Swanyam, Prakritim Vidhi Meparam, 7.5. Explain to the people about this. Then 15.7, what is it? Mame Vamsho Jivaloke Jivabhuta. So in this way, you explain to people that is material energy, that is spiritual energy, and the jiva is only a part and parcel of the Supreme Lord. Correct, no? You explain these things to people. Once energy understanding comes, people will become very sober. Because they will know Krishna is the central figurehead and everything is revolving around him. So Lord and his energies is the first paragraph here, which is very important to explain. And he cannot be known by speculation. You have to study the Shastra. That's what Prabhupada is quoting so many things. In this para, you will see that. So, and energy means what? Like, for example, I heard that one Parsi fellow in Pune, he's got 20 houses, I heard. And two houses means one of the houses is our camp temple, which is about 2 acres land. Like that, he has how many? 20. And he lives in one of those bungalows, he stays. Now, the other houses became like 100 years old. So, what he has to do? Demolish them and make new one. And do you think he's an old man? How can he do it? How does he do it? Okay, you can get employees, but what he needs to get the work done by the employees? What he needs? Money, Lakshmi. So Vishnu has Lakshmi or not? His pocket is empty or he has Lakshmi? He has a source of all Lakshmi, you know, he has, correct, no? So if this fellow can, you know, demolish and rebuild all the 20 houses now, simply by throwing money. You said, no, throw peanuts and get monkeys, you say, no? Isn't it? Throw money and guys will come. Throw some bugs and people will come and run to do this and do that. So in this world, you will see the energy you need for getting everything done is money. And similarly, you will find there is Lakpati, there is Karadupati, Arapati, Karapati. But Lord Vishnu is Lakshmipati. So all the Lakshmi of all the universes belong to him. So do you think any difficulty for him in getting anything done? That is how you can understand. This is only one of the energies of Vishnu. There is Nila Shakti, there is Bhu Shakti. Similarly, there is Antaranga Shakti, Bahiranga Shakti, Tatasa Shakti. Similarly, there is Sambit, Sandini, Hladini. Many, many Shaktis are there like this. Icha Shakti, Kriya Shakti, Jnana Shakti, Brahma Shakti, Vishnu Shakti, Shiva Shakti. All these Shaktis means the feminine forms. And if you read in Bhagavatam, you find Hri, Bhu, many other Shaktis also. Where it comes, I will tell you. 10th canto, 14th chapter, 13th, 14th chapter, you will read Brahma Vimohan Leela. When Lord Krishna showed the covered boys transformed into Vishnu forms. To whom? Brahma. There you will read what all Shaktis Brahma saw along with Vishnu. Something like 12 or 14 prominent Shaktis show up there, you will find. So all the Shaktis are all at the beck and call of the Lord and they are coming and begging Lord for service. Even in Yashoda's binding Damodar Leela pastime, you know, first Vibhuti Shakti manifested and the Vibhuti Shakti saw the Lord's desire. Hey, Krishna wants to go for stealing butter, but Yashoda is trying to bind him. Can he go for stealing? So Vibhuti Shakti did not allow her to bind. Therefore, the Shaktis are the ones who do all the activity, you know. Vibhushakti, the same Shakti which manifested the Vishwarupa, Darshanam in 11th chapter of Bhagavad Gita. And that Shakti came now and not allowed Yashoda to bind. Because the Shaktis know the Lord's desire and exactly they act accordingly. And then after some time, even before that one more Shakti came, Sankalpa Shakti, which is desire potency. The Krishna thought in his mind, I want to go for stealing butter, but Mother Yashoda is trying to bind me. If she binds me, what will happen to me? That is Sankalpa Shakti. Then immediately Sankalpa Shakti saw his desire and then that Sankalpa Shakti called for Vibhuti Shakti. Satya Sankalpa Shakti. So Vibhuti Shakti came and then said, don't worry, now we will not allow her to bind. Then after some time, Yashoda had perspiration drops on her forehead and the hair was disheveled. Then what Shakti came? Kripa Shakti came. And then Kripa Shakti told other two Shaktis, now you both retire now. Now it's my time now. So she came and told the Lord, my dear Lord, As per your desire, we will allow her to bind you because you want to show mercy towards her. And then she was able to bind. Now, I'm just telling you one pastime, how the Shaktis are very swiftly acting. You can see that. There is one very prominent energy called Leela Shakti. Huh? This Leela Shakti is so powerful, it will even put the Lord to excitement also. Like for example, one time Rukmini was finding Krishna. At that time Krishna said, why did you marry me, Rukmini? You see, I am a covered boy. There are many other greater kings like Shishupal who want to marry you. They have so much wealth and they are great kings. I don't have any post and people don't even know my caste, whether I am Vaishya or a Kshatriya. Some people say I was born to Kshatriya and then I went and lived in Vaishya's house. You know, and also, so people don't respect me. I'm not a big king. I'm just a covered boy. Even now, it's not lady can marry. Something like that Krishna said. His idea was what? To make her angry. And he wanted to make her angry like Satyabhama. What did she do? Oh, she was fanning Krishna with the chamar. She just dropped it. Tada, she fell. At that time, it is said that, you know, even Krishna was amazed. Because he didn't anticipate that she will do this. So he didn't anticipate. Then how did she do that? That was arranged by Leela Shakti. This Leela Shakti wants to excite the Lord. And give wonderment to him and to his devotees also. Both. Now you may say, how can Leela Shakti surpass the Lord? You may say. No, Lord allows freedom to Leela Shakti to surpass him. To excite him. Otherwise, if there is no excitement, then how the pastime will be relishable? Isn't it? Then immediately Krishna extends his two extra arms and lifts the Rukmini and sprinkles water on her face and everything. So, in this way, sometimes even Lord doesn't know what's going to happen next. Another place where Leela Shakti comes into picture is when Krishna did not want the covered boys to enter the mouth of Agasura. And Leela Shakti saw that Lord and the devotees have two different desires. What was devotees' desire? To enter the... Because they were saying, Are Bhakavan Minangshasi, they are saying. That Baka was killed by this Bakari. Who is Bakari? Krishna. So he killed Baka Asura before. Now if you enter the mouth of Agasura, it is not our problem. Who should save us? Krishna should save us. And they were clapping hands and singing Krishna's names and they entered into the mouth of Agasura. So at that time, Dilashati was wondering, Krishna doesn't want them to enter, but they want to enter. Which of the two desires she should fulfill? So she was... So you can understand Leela Shakti's job is how difficult it is. Correct, no? At that time she thought that because Lord is omnipotent and omnipresent and omniscient, he's all powerful also. It's not difficult for him to save them. And also, in this instance, the covered boy's desire was to show the prowess of Krishna to the whole world. So they wanted to glorify Krishna. Therefore they went in. So she allowed their desire to be fulfilled, knowing that Lord will be more pleased if I allow this. And then Krishna also enters after that. That means Krishna bowed down to the desire of his devotees. Just like, you know, Shastras say, don't cross the ocean and go to the west because there are mlechas, yavanas, chandalas. They say that. But Prabhupada took a jaladuta and went. Naturally, the Lord would be wondering, hey, he's entering into Agasura's mouth. America is like Agasura only, correct, no? Because it's a prohibited place in the Shastra. But Krishna thought, because my pure devotee is going there, I also have to go there. So Krishna also entered America, correct, no? And then he propagated everywhere, all over the world. So, in this way you will see that, you know, all the Shaktis are assisting him. Go ahead, next para.
Thus the different energies of the Lord...
Like for example, Krishna doesn't kill anybody. Who kills then? Samhara Shakti. There is one Shakti of Krishna called Samhara Shakti. Whenever Krishna wants to kill any demon, he will just do some action like this, but killing is actually done by Samhara Shakti. Yeah. Like for example, he drank the milk from Putana, isn't it? He took milk, but who drank the halahal, the kalakuta poison? Who drank? Shiva. For that Shankara he called. That is Shankara's department, drinking halahal. Therefore, Shankara is available in this world for dealing with the material energy. Krishna will only drink milk because milk is coming with love. But the poison is coming with hatred. So he told Shankara, you deal with that. You are the fellow who has all this Virabhadra, Kala Bhairava and all these fellows. You deal with a horrible Shakti and I will deal only with milk because I only accept love. See, this is how the different Shaktis help him. Yeah, go ahead.
Although his energies are innumerable, they can be divided into three principal categories. The internal potency, the marginal potency and the external potency. There are hundreds and millions of subheadings to each of these categories. The dominating demigods who are empowered to control and administer such natural phenomena as air, light and rain are all classified within the marginal potency of the absolute person.
Yeah, air, light, all this means Vayu, Agni, Indra, like we read in the Kena Upanishad now, correct, no? Like that.
Lesser living beings, including humans, who also belong to the Lord's marginal potency. The material world is the creation of the Lord's external potency, and the spiritual sky, where the kingdom of God is situated, is the manifestation of His internal potency.
Yeah, some people foolishly think that all this Agni, Indra, Chandra, Vayu and all this, these are all imaginations or mythological. They feel like that, especially modern educated people. But how this thought process came, it came from the Indologists who came to India. And the goal of the Indologists was to study Sanskrit and mutilate and misinterpret all the scriptures and make the Hindus lose faith in their own. Two things they wanted to do. One thing is destroy their faith in Vedic literature, because they thought that if they have the faith in Vedic literature, we can't propagate their own religion like Christianity and others. So they wanted to destroy that faith. Second thing, they wanted to change the culture of India. Indians were wearing dhoti kurta. So they wanted them to wear coat, pant, shirt, hat. This thing they wanted to wear. And also, Indians would keep long shika, you know, shave an head and go to the gurukulas. And they had a lot of faith in the Vedic type of education. So they wanted to give them modern education. And all these items like, coffee, tea, liquor, and all this potatoes and tomato. Many things are introduced. Tomatoes and this chili. Many things are introduced in India by them. When the British came here like that. So the goal of the Indologists was to turn away the educated boys from the Vedic type of, not only education, the Vedic culture itself. They wanted to uproot the Vedic culture and establish the Mlecha culture here. Today, can you go to college or school with this dhoti kurta? No. In fact, companies have, IT companies I know, one day in a week, you can wear any dress you want. Correct, no? IT companies allow that. So some girls, they come in saris. That's the only day they come in sari or something like that. Or men also wear some kurta pajama. They can wear and go like that. So if you want to go like Hare Krishna devotee also, you can go. Even companies allow that. If you see like that, occasionally people wear that type of thing. But if you see in colleges, you will not find one boy wearing dhoti kurta. Can you find? You cannot. Because, the British have thoroughly established their culture here. And when you wear, people laugh at us. Actually, we have to laugh at them. Correct, no? For wearing pants. So, at that time, you will see this type of doubts and all they created. They said, see, our Bible is good because there is only one God. But in this Hindu scripture, there are too many gods. And these are all imaginative gods of all shapes and forms and everything. Don't put trust in this. But actually, if you see, Prabhupada logically proves it. He says that, you are taking so much light from the sun, you are not paying anything. But even for this bulb, you have to pay to electricity board. Correct, no? Similarly, water bottle, bistari bottle, you are paying money. But then you are taking water from the clouds. Whom are you paying? And then Prabhupada always gives very logical. Then he says, some people may say, oh, this is coming from the nature. And this is like saying, oh, this is coming from the public water tank. So why should I pay for that water? That is all right. It's coming from the water tank. But then who is filling it up? Municipality. And if you don't pay to municipality, what they will do? They'll cut your supply. Similarly, if you don't do yajna and pay to the demigods, then the rains will reduce. And we are practically seeing it nowadays. Because the spiritual activities have reduced. And the rains are also not coming. There is a anavrishti everywhere. Yeah, and many farmers are committing suicide. There's a food production problem. Because when people don't worship God, they become more greedy. When they become more greedy, they grow tobacco. Instead of growing rice and wheat and everything. And also, even to grow tobacco, you'll need water. They're not getting water only. You can see that. So, therefore, Prabhupada presented it very solidly. That the natural phenomenon which you see, that phenomenon cannot happen on its own. Just like, for example, in your home, the water tank doesn't get filled on its own. You have to put on the switch for motor. Then the water gets filled up. Then the water comes down. Correct, no? In the same manner, if you look at the phenomenon of how the rain takes place, it absorbs water from the ocean, it becomes clouds. If you study thermodynamics, there is a Y chart, we call it. The Y chart has, it looks like a Y. There is the ice zone. There is a water zone, there is a steam zone. by when you change the pressure, volume, temperature conditions. So you will see when the water is in the ocean, when it evaporates, for that then it is different PVT. Then it is moved by the winds. Then the clouds again, you have to change PVT to condensate. So Prabhupada's logical question is what? Now who is changing the PVT? Somebody is changing now. On its own, how it can change? Correct, no? And how the water is becoming steam-like, and the steam becoming water and becoming ice. All this change, how is it happening? Because material things don't act on its own. Fan is rotating because somebody switched on the fan, correct, no? Well, now as soon as you come to know, on its own, can the fan start? I think my devotees have come now, let me start now. Will it start on its own? Of course, we have a sensor, it will start. And but sensor, who has put it? Somebody has put it. So you will never find, in fact, PMM, perpetual motion machine, which is thermodynamic first law, that is only in paper only. Nobody has done a machine which functions on its own, which doesn't need external energy. There is no such machine. It is only a, what you call it, hypothetical machine. So in this world, you will never find anything acting on its own. So that being the case, Prabhupada's question is, how are the natural phenomena functioning? Who is behind it? Therefore, the intelligent design has again come back to acceptance amongst learned circles nowadays. Because they understood that the natural phenomenon is highly complex, and the highly complex thing cannot function on its own. Because we know the computer models are all highly complex and we are behind it. How can the natural phenomenon, which is far more highly complex, how can it function on its own? Therefore, the demigods are the marginal potency of the Lord. Next para. Thus,
the different energies of the Lord are present everywhere. Although the Lord and His energies are non-different, one should not mistake these energies for the Supreme Truth. Nor should one wrongly consider that the Supreme Lord is distributed everywhere impersonally, or that He loses His personal existence. Men are accustomed to reaching the conclusions according to their capacity for understanding. But the Supreme Lord is not subject to our limited capacity for understanding. It is for this reason that the Upanishads warn us that no one can approach the Lord by his own limited potency.
Yeah. See the article here. Many gods are one. You're showing it? Yeah, the five prominent deities and their universal meaning, the Panchopasana. You can see this article, very important article. See, it's 5 pages, so I will only show the important part. I will show you. Five primary gods, you can see this. Okay, I'll give you a little bit of clue of what it is. You see, how the worship gradually evolves in a person's life. Here you see the five primary gods of Panchopasana, and their numerous variations may be seen in three ways. First, they are alternate faces of one absolute reality who assist in administration of the universe. Second, in this service, they are separate beings performing cosmic functions. Thirdly, they also represent categories of religious practice that indicate specific levels of spiritual understanding, which is what I was telling you. So I will just show it now. Here, Bhaktivinoda Thakur has explained it. Yeah, I read this. According to
Srila Bhaktivinoda.
Is it big enough? I'll make it a little bigger.
According to Srila Bhaktivinoda, the initial quest for spirit or Brahman is a form of Shakta Dharma, worship of Shakti or energy, for it recognizes nature as divine.
Yeah, this is the first step. People see, oh, nature is providing me rains, it's giving me light, it's giving me wind, everything, thank you. Then they bow down to nature, respecting nature. Similarly, from Bhumi only, all the grains and everything comes. So, even before passing stool and urine, they pray to Bhumi and say, I'm going to do this horrible act now. On you, I'm going to put some stool and urine. Please kindly forgive me. There is a prayer. Some people chant. I have to chant the Sanskrit mantra before passing stool. The Vedic time, because you go to the bushes and all, no? So in this way, they treat the nature as divine. Shakti. So they are called Shaktas. Correct, no? That's the first. And then?
For the Shakta, there is more to what we see than meets the eye. Mother nature is alive and fundamentally spiritual. In its most basic form, Shakta Dharma consists of worshipping Prakriti or material nature, but it can develop to the more sophisticated forms of Durga worship existing in India from time immemorial. Nonetheless, it is still a rudimentary form of spiritual awareness, with practitioners often still given to meat eating and other low-grade material activities. It is a beginning, a dawning of spiritual awareness.
Correct, na? You understood, na? First worship is of Shakti. So therefore, many people say, Prakriti is the mother, she is giving everything, so they worship Durga. As a personified material energy.
When one's spiritual inclinations mature, one understands that there is heat at the center of all we see, feel, taste, touch and smell. The sun, Surya, gives us life, nurturing us with warmth and light.
You have to open that window.
Our digestion is a kind of fire that ignites our bodies with gusto, allowing us to move about in the world.
Yeah, I can close it.
This is Saurya Dharma. According to Bhakti Vinod Thakur, when God consciousness grows stronger, the realization that heat is the preeminent power affecting all activities in the material world comes, and one rises to the second stage, the worship of the source of all heat, the sun, Surya Deva. Yeah.
Without fire, can you cook in the kitchen? Without fire in your belly, can you digest the food? Without the sunlight, can there be chlorophyll produced by photosynthesis in the plants? Is it possible? That means nothing can move without the fire. Correct, no? Now, without the warmth of the sun, actually out of the heat and the cold, you know, living entities cannot tolerate cold, but they can tolerate heat, it is said. Extreme cold, people die. But heat, so the warmth of the sun is very necessary for life to exist. So in this way, understanding that sun is the supplier of the energy, first they worship energy itself. Then they understand sun is the source of that energy. Then they worship sun. They are called Shauryas. Yeah. They worship Surya Deva. Yeah. Then? After this?
Thus, the different energies of the Lord are present everywhere. Although the Lord...
What are they doing? Here. Next one. After this, one realizes... Okay, I'll read it. After this, one realizes that even this magnificent energy, great though it may be, is still just a mundane force generated from subsisting in the material world. Then Bhaktivinoda Thakur calls this higher realization as Ganapati Dharma, wherein one realizes that the living beings hold the secret to higher spiritual reality. At this stage, an awareness evolves that animated living entities are more important than energetic abstractions. And gods such as Ganesha and other creatures of nature rise to prominence as the object of one's worship. Such a realization often manifests itself as the first seeds of humanism. Okay, now I'll explain this. They actually, when they understand that, okay, the nature is Shakti from which we are deriving everything. For example, how the earth is able to give you grains? Because sun is pouring down rain. Correct, no? Now, how are we able to get potable drinking water to drink? Because without water, you can't survive. And that is also made possible by the sun only. Heat of the sun evaporates the water and then pours down as rain. So, when they understand that this energy is there, but energy cannot do everything on its own without, the Shakti cannot do anything without the sun. So, therefore, the worship goes to Saurya. Now, after that, they understand worship of the Surya is not great. They are more superior to Jada Vastu. So the totality of all the jivas existing in the world, they deserve the life that exists in this world deserves reverence. That means one should not harm any life. One should respect all life. Life is superior to Jada. Chetan is superior to Jada. Therefore, worshipping all the living in this together is called Ganapatya. You have heard this Ganas, no? Bhuta Gana. Gana means actually group. So it's called Ganapatya Dharma. Then the Ganapati worship came after that. Ganesha and other creatures of the nature rise. That came after that. And then?
But this evolves further and one realizes that all creatures reach their pinnacle in man. As Srila Bhaktivinoda writes, the fourth stage is the worship of purely human consciousness in the form of Shiva, Shaiva Dharma. Here, one looks for an empowered personality, a more human-like divinity with whom one can identify. The idea of becoming one with this divine embodiment becomes desirable, and spirituality here consists of unitary recognition, seeing one's identity with all that is and with the Supreme. In this way, Shaiva Dharma puts forward a non-theistic spirituality, often focusing on monism or even enhanced humanity.
Now we understand how the Shiva worship emerges. First, you are only having humanitarian conception towards all jivas, that is Ganapati Dharma. And from humanitarian, you go to spirituality, where you understand Shiva is the role model of a perfect meditator, he is Yogishwar. So, two things you want to do. One is you want to become perfect human being, like Shiva. At same time, you want to see oneness in all the living entities, because the life that lives in all the bodies is ultimately consciousness. So, these things called Shaiva Dharma comes. And finally, coming to the fifth stage, one understands there's a difference between particle of consciousness, Jiva, that serves the personality of Supreme Consciousness, which is Vishnu, and that is called Vaishnava Dharma. See how it develops. Now you come to, this is called Panchopasana. And he is giving examples all over the world. Pantheism, Shamanism, Neo-Paganism, many, many other things he has said all around the world. They all can be resolved by understanding this Panchopasana. That's his point. So all this, Bhaktivinoda Thakur has very scientifically written all these things. Actually, this is either Jaiva Dharma or Chaitanya Shikshamrita. This is an article, I think, published in BTG, I think. So, now you got an idea, no? How the gradual development. What is the first one? Shaktas. Shaktas. Then above? Shauryas. Above? Ganapatyas. Then? Shaivas. Then? Vaishnavas. This is Panchopasana. Now, this Panchopasana was started by Shankaracharya, based on the Puranas. So, why he made it, I will tell you the reason. Shankaracharya thought that if I tell the people to worship impersonal Brahman directly, it will be difficult for them. So let them worship these deities, and then gradually as they evolve more and more to the higher and higher stages, then you can leave these deities and then focus on Brahman as the one supreme. Ekam satyam dutiyam nasti, and then merge in Brahman and then become Brahman. That is called as paramarthika stage. That is pratibhashika, yavaharika, paramarthika. So, in the lower two stages, he wanted the people to do this type of worship of the murtis. And this is the reason why after the Ganesh Utsav, people do visarjan after 1 week. Correct? No? Because in 1 week you are worshipping, now you become so exalted that you put the deity in the water. Vaishnavas will never do that. Vaishnavas will never give up murti puja, and they will never stop mantra ucharan. You know, it's an eternal activity for Vaishnavas. Whereas for Mayavadis, it is a temporary self-serving activity, this Panchopasana. So we don't follow this Panchopasana system. Only the Mayavadis follow that. Go ahead.
Thus, the different energies of the Lord are present everywhere. Although the Lord and His energies are non-different, one should not mistake these energies for the Supreme Truth. Nor should one wrongly consider that the Supreme Lord is distributed everywhere impersonally, or that He loses His personal existence. Men are accustomed to reaching conclusions according to their capacity for understanding, but the Supreme Lord is not subject to our limited capacity for understanding. It is for this reason that the Upanishads warn us that no one can approach the Lord by his own limited potency.
Actually, many people are worshipping Shakti, but the Shakti is not independent of Shaktiman. For example, Vishnu produces Brahma in the lotus without taking help of Lakshmi, Prabhupada says. Shaktiman can produce a baby without taking help of Shakti. Therefore, one should know Shaktiman is superior to Shakti. Shakti is subordinate. So, although Shaktis are doing many things, the Shaktis actually always fulfill the will of the Shaktiman. And they will also remain subordinate to Shaktiman. These two are very important. This is explained in the scriptures that although Shakti, Shaktimati or Abhedaha, it is said, sometimes the Shaktiman will become subordinate to Shakti when love predominates. When the Tattva predominates, then Shakti becomes subordinate to Shaktiman. So this should be understood. Just like father and son are having a stunt, who wins? Son wins. Because father may be Mike Tyson, but with son he will be defeated, just to give joy to the son. But when Mike Tyson actually goes for a match, who wins? Yeah. In Tattva, Lord is superior. And in Leela, Shakti is superior. Lord allows the Shakti to be superior. Like that, yeah. So therefore, Prabhupada is saying, one shouldn't think Shakti is ultimate. Shakti is subordinate to Shaktiman. And also, Lord Goloka Nivasati, but Akhilatma Bhuto. He remains in one place, like the light of the sun spreads everywhere. His energies are spreading everywhere and Lord can do. Like if you go to Tata Company, everywhere you find Tata. Tata in the fan, Tata in the table, Tata Sumo going, everything is Tata is going, correct, no? So Tata name is everywhere, correct, no? Although Tata is sitting in one place in the office, correct, no? He may be personally present. But all the things in Tata Company belong to Tata. If you're working in the Tata Company, working in the machine also is put Tata. Correct, no? Tata or Ashok Leyland or whatever, correct, no? Like that. Similarly, in the material world, any object you touch, the mic you touch, whose is this? It's Krishna's. This is Krishna's, this is Krishna's, Krishna's. Everything is Krishna's only. So, in this way, Lord has spreaded in the form of energies, Prabhupada is saying. So, you cannot think that, you know, because he has spreaded, it's like paper, you cut it into pieces. Therefore, he says, Om Purna Madaha, Purnam, and Purnat, Purnam Udachyate. Many, many complete units come from him. And he remains complete. So, I gave you, if you remember, 3-4 examples Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gives in the argument with Prakashananda Saraswati. Like a Parasamani produces a lot of gold objects, but remains as it is. Sun produces light for crores of years and it remains Ashesha Teja. Correct, no? And tree. The tree produces many leaves, you know, many, many flowers and fruits and all. And the fruits, leaves are keep falling away and the tree remains in one place. Like that Krishna gives out many, many brahmandas from him and he remains as it is. So therefore, he doesn't become diminished. That's the main point. Go ahead, next para.
In the Bhagavad Gita 10.2, the Lord says that not even the great rishis and suras can know him.
Name Buddhaswaragana Prabhavam Namaharishayaha Aham Adirhi Devanam Maharishinam Chasarvashaha.
This is one. And Bhagavatam Muhyanti Atsurayaha. Correct, no? Muhyanti means bewildered. Who? Even demigods that bewildered in understanding me, he is saying. Here also he is saying Name Viduhu means what? And they cannot know who? Name Suragana. Like Brahma got Brahmavihungan Leela. Indra, you know, was defeated in the Govardhan Leela. Isn't it? Shiva ran behind Mohini Murthy. You will see that all demigods are Muhyanti Atsuraya. That's what he's saying here. And the fourth mantra of Vishwamitra very clearly suggests that the absolute truth is ultimately the absolute person. Otherwise, there would have been no need to mention so many details in support of his personal futures. So, basically, he's saying God is not impersonal because when you read the Upanishads very carefully, they bring a person to personal understanding over a period of time. Why? Because people have just now left Karmakanda and come to the Jnanakanda. They are not in a position to immediately surrender to the Lord. They need something mystical to understand. So the Upanishads indirectly explain. But ultimately they come to the right understanding as Lord is a person. Although the individual person possesses of the Lord's potencies have all the symptoms of the Lord himself, they have limited spheres of activity and therefore all limited. And the parts and parcels are never equal to the whole. Therefore, they cannot appreciate the Lord's full potency. Under the influence of material nature, foolish and ignorant living beings who are but parts and parcels of the Lord try to conjecture about the Lord's transcendental position. Sri Ishopanishad warns of the futility of trying to establish the identity of the Lord through mental speculation. Why don't you try to learn of the transcendence from the Lord himself, the supreme source of the Vedas? For the Lord alone has full knowledge of transcendence. So two very important points are mentioned here. Please all of you repeat. Part is a part.
Part is a part.
Whole is a whole.
Whole is a whole.
This is the very first thing we have to know very well. Jiva Jiva is a part and Lord is the whole. Now, for example, you see a tiny Jiva in the form of a pilot, you know, walks in an airport towards a large plane which is carrying 1500 passengers. What do you call it? Airbus, they call it. It's a huge, long one. And more than 1,000 passengers sitting. And this fellow walks towards the plane and he enters the plane and sits in the cockpit and the plane takes off. In this way, you can see that Chetan, living entity, you know, he, it's not that he has no freedom. He has some amount of freedom. You know, he is making a plane fly. He is making the trains move fast. So many things he is doing. But he is not independent. So Prabhupada is saying, it is not that Jiva has no independence, but he has limited independence. One man told Prabhupada, Swamiji, such a miracle man has done. See the aeroplane flying. Prabhupada said, what is so great about it? When the petrol is over, it will come down. It's not that it's going to be flying forever. But look at the Saturn, Jupiter, they never came down. And they keep going round and round and for millions of years. God can do that. Because it is God's creation. In God's creation, you don't need to put petrol again. Once you make them rotating, till the Lord tells them keep rotating, they'll keep rotating. The Lord says, now there is pralaya, now, you know, stop, they'll stop. Everything happens. Madhubayat? Pati vatoyam. Suryastapati madhubayat. Varshati indro. Dhat yagnir. Mutrishtarati madhubayat. The sun rises out of fear of the Lord. You know, the rain showers because of fear of the Lord. The wind blows and the death takes its toll. Everyone is performing on his order perfectly. But in our case, we find the material world, it gives you ups and downs always. You will see that. Therefore, Prabhupada is establishing that one point, that part is a part, whole is a whole. Jiva is a part, so he has minute freedom. And Lord is a whole, he has absolute freedom. Swarat. The first verse of 1.1.1 Bhagavatam. That is one point. Second point he says, being limited, we should not do mental speculation, he is saying. Prabhupada used to very strongly oppose mental speculation. You should only learn in Guru Parampara about the Lord. If you are going to speculate, you know, you are always likely to come to the wrong conclusion. Like there was a blind man, his friend told him, hey, I have brought some, hot milk for you. Have you ever had milk in your life? He said, I have never drank milk in my life, he said. Anyway, today you drink and say it will be very nice. The blind man said, can you please tell me how it will be so that I get an idea? He said, milk is so completely pure like a crane, he said. How does a crane look like? Can you please tell me? So he took the blind man's hand like this and he bent it like this, bent the finger like this. Your crane looks like this. And I said, now you get an idea how crane looks? He said, yes. And the crane is completely white, like this milk, he said. Then the man said, then I will not drink milk. He said, why? If I drink it, it will get stuck in my throat. You know, if you put the milk in the... And that is the understanding he got about what? This is called speculation. With a blind man speculating, it's like the blind man's bluff, we say, no? Good for Andayata Andayir. Upaniyamanas tepisha tantriyam urdhamni baddha. It's like one blind man is running towards the ocean and telling all other blind men, just catch my collar, or catch my kurta, I will take you. And where is he taking? Everybody is going to plunge everybody in ocean. It's like that. Foolish. Therefore, Prabhupada used to say, this kind of speculation has ruined this world. So many people, politicians are writing commentary to Bhagavad Gita and bluffing. There are so many, you know, nowadays many novels are also coming. Like if you see this Amish Tripathi and all these people, they're writing on Sita. And a lot of new additions they have made, which has now no connection to Ramayana at all. And it is deadly. Because people are going to be thoroughly confused what is there in the Mula Ramayana. And they are adding so many other new stories of their own fiction and all to make it attractive and things like that. In order to fit, they put new masala on their own. So therefore, Prabhupada says this kind of speculation will lead one nowhere. So one should hear in Guru Parampara perfect knowledge, which is unadulterated, untouched by Maya. Every part and parcel. So two things he said. One is part is a part, whole is a whole. We are only tiny parts. Therefore, we should not speculate. Here in Guru Parampara. Every part and parcel of complete whole is endowed with some particular energy to act according to Lord's will. When the part and parcel living entity forgets his particular activities and the Lord's will is considered to be in Maya, from the very beginning, Sri Yashopanishad wants us to be careful to play the part designated for us by the Lord. This does not mean that the individual has no initiative of his own. Because he is part and parcel of the Lord, he must partake of the initiative of the Lord as well. When a person properly utilizes the initiative or active nature with intelligence, understanding that everything is the Lord's potency, he can revive his original consciousness, which was lost due to association with Maya, external energy. All power is obtained from the Lord. Therefore, each particular power must be utilized to execute the will of the Lord and not otherwise. The Lord can be known by one who has adopted such a submissive service attitude. Perfect knowledge means knowing the Lord in all his futures. All his futures means Brahman, Paramatma, Bhagavan, and also the Dashavataras, and also different like the Swamsha, Vibhinnamsha, all those expansions. knowing his potencies and knowing all his energies, knowing how these potencies work by his will. These matters are described by the Lord in the Bhagavad Gita, the essence of all the Upanishads. So, here again, Prabhupada is saying two things here, very important things. Here, one thing is that the jiva is always subordinate to God. Therefore, in this particular verse, the devatas are running and the Lord is walking. But who is winning? Like that story of Kena Upanishad we heard. So, Lord is always superior and we are always subordinate. We should not forget this fact. And jiva should not try to surpass the Lord, saying that I will take some initiative of my own. If your initiative is independent and not in line with the Lord, and that initiative only will bring headache, like we have seen the modern day advancement. Like man, Prabhupada says, man thought that we will take, instead of the horses in the towns, we will convert them into a motor car and convert the horse into horsepower. That's what man did. But what is the difference between a horse carriage and a horsepower wala motor car? If you see, the horse is only past tool, which is organic. Whereas the motor car emanates carbon monoxide, which gives so much poison. And that is man-made. Horse carriage is made by God, and motor car is made by man. And have you ever heard that a horse carriage or a bullock cart hit some people and 200 people died? But in America, here, when there is one car crash, 200, 300 people can die. How? Because cars go at 200 miles per hour very normally. They go so fast. So one car wala attended a mobile call or something, was careless. You know, next wala hits him, everybody dies. So man's creation creates pollution and accidents. Whereas God's creation, no pollution, no accidents. Just see. Therefore, man should not imitate thinking that God is taking initiative, I will also take initiative. No, you can take initiative, but in line with him. Don't try to act independently, he's saying. So therefore, know that like hands, you know, hand is able to count, hand is able to stop a falling object, hand is able to grasp an object. These potencies of the hand come from its connection to the body. If you cut off the hand, which is like a jiva, the jiva is like a part of the body, no? Part of the Lord's. So if a jiva cuts off from the Lord and tries to be independent, he becomes asar, good for nothing. So the Ishapanishad, this verse tells us that like the devatas, they have no power on their own, but Lord empowers them. Similarly, the hand has no power of its own. The bodily connection empowers it. So the jiva is like that. That's the whole point here. So then we get perfect understanding of our actual situation. So in essence, in this verse, half of the verse, we devoted time to understanding Lord and his energies. And the other half of the verse talks about the jiva's, subordinate position to the Lord. These two things. Srila Prabhupada ki. Okay, one thing I can show you here. You can see this one. We are seeing mantra 4. Absolute truth can't be understood by speculation. Revelation helps us and God and his energies. And energy is non-different yet different. And we are limited and we can only understand limitedly. The Lord has to reveal to us. Play your part and you'll be given understanding. That means even the Kena Upanishad said, the Guru told the disciple, if you worship the Lord, then he will give you understanding. Thank you. Srila Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki. Thank you very much.